Carbs are in, and I didn't film it for a bunch of reasons, actually, that turned out that it would have been difficult to see, and at the same time, it would have been kind of difficult to listen to me cursing and swearing and scraping my knuckles and stuff. It's not an easy job to do. The carbs are kind of tight. There's a couple of screws that a lot of people replace with Allen, like an M6. It's that one right there, and maybe you can see it or not, but there's one in the back as well. So there's two screws that, or two bolts that hold the carburetor onto the body, and then there's that bracket, that clamp that holds it all down as well. And the whole thing's got to get sort of jimmied in from the left side. And I'll go around to the other side and I'll show you on this side what it looks like. So, same thing on this carburetor. So that's number one, the left eye. This is one that was giving me all the trouble and grief. But anyway, everything's been cleaned up inside the frame where the air inlets come down. There's going to be a little joint right there, because the air filter is actually on the other side. The air travels through the frame, through this frame member here. I had a little bit of a struggle with this because I ended up taking that wire loom off, putting it above that bracket, and then forgetting it to put it down before I put the carburetors in. And I had to loosen everything off and wrestle with that. So it's a bit of a job. Not easy, but everything's in, everything's the only thing that hasn't been done, of course, is I haven't connected those little channels. And of course, on this side is the mixture control valve. That's where those two lines are for. And the mixture control valve only goes to the front cylinder. And it's there for a couple of reasons. It's there to minimize backfiring when you roll the throttle off, and then it also gets connected to the boost, which is up here in the valves. There's a little transducer up here. I don't know if you can see it or not, but anyway, there's a little transducer up there, and it senses vacuum, and it sends a signal back to the TCU, which is actually back in behind here. And the TCU just changes the timing, it advances it or retards it necessary, so that you don't get backfiring. And that, of course, adding that air leans out the mixture. So when I got the bike, I noticed that the fuel lines were routed incorrectly on this one. They were coming back here to the back of the bike. And of course, that's a risk, because if there was a leak, there'd be a fire there for sure. And also, it would heat the fuel up just the way it was laying. So I took photographs, of course, to make sure everything went back the way it was. But again, and I mentioned this before, don't take it all for granted that because you're taking something off, a part off, that it's the right one, or the routing of a hose or anything like that. So this is the way the hose comes up. There's a heat proof hose that comes up to the middle, splits into a T, and then comes down on the left side and goes over to the right side. And that's the right way to route that hose. There's two vacuum lines on the front. You can probably see those there. And then back on the carburetor on this side of this one, that little capped out cover right there, that's the one that's going to come off. It's capped normally, and it's just going to come off for service when we do the synchronization. So that's all that. The fuel lines are all run the way they're supposed to be run. And that's, of course, when I looked at the photos again, there's no fuel lines in those clips, and that's what those clips are for. The mags, not mags, the coils. I had to repair the coils. I fixed the caps, replaced those, and the wire was corroded, so I pulled those back a little bit. I still got a little bit left. I have ordered new coils. The coils sit right under here, and there's obviously a left, which is a shorter one, and the right, which is the longer one, goes back to the aft cylinder, number one cylinder. And so that's where the little vacuum device is right there. But that's where the coils are. And again, there's a right way to route that coil wire all the way down. And I brought it out here, and that's where it's going to go for now. And again, the new cap for that as well. Now, these caps have a 1K resistor because there is 5K in the spark plug. And that'll kind of bring it back to the way it was when it was stock with the old style plugs that are no longer available. So anyway, that's I've left, like I said, I've left that little vacuum line just ready to go. It's on. The fuel lines are all connected properly, routed the way they're supposed to be routed. I checked the throttle lines. They've all been throttle cables. They've all been checked for slack. You just roll the steering back and forth. I'll leave these off because I have to get there's little pipes that go down into the frame so that this one connects to the frame, and that one over there is where the air filter connects to. So kind of an odd thing to do, but that's how Viragos do it. There's a couple of vent lines here. They're just vents. They don't need to be. They're not vacuum lines, so they're just vent lines there. But anyway, that's it. That's all buttoned up in a nutshell. Like I said, it's all. I've checked all the nuts and bolts and screws and hardware. The choke cables on the other side, it was adjusted, like I did the throttle. I'm going to reinstall the fuel tank, put the battery back in. I bought a new AGM battery, the gel. They have the least amount of dip under high current load, which these V-twins, these Viragos, obviously takes a lot of current to flip these things over. So the AGM battery was my choice. It doesn't have to be vented. It's non-spillable. So that's that. So that's where we're at. So valves are done. Carburetors were overhauled completely. Spark plugs, the coils are still original, but the wires have been repaired. New caps, new plugs, and new battery. So what we'll do is I'll stop it here. I'm going to finish tidying up a few things. You don't need to see that, but I'll tidy up a few things and I'll get the I'll start getting the fuel tank on and getting that sorted out as well. So fuel tank goes here. It's a bit of a drag, but I figured out a pretty cool way. Instead of lifting it up, I rock it to the left and right to access the hoses. It's kind of a convoluted thing to do, but it can be challenging. Now inside there, yeah, I don't know if you can. The camera's picking it up. Hold on. That's a set screw for the carburetor synchronization. So I'm gonna get the fuel tank installed. I guess I'll clean it up and just go over, just make sure I didn't miss anything. Get the battery in. Get the fuel tank on, and we'll see if it runs, which I'm pretty sure it will. Hopeful anyway. I've got the bike back together, as you can see, and cleaned it up a little bit too. You can see the carbs look really nice and clean. I don't know if the GoPro will get that in there or not, but there's the left one. We're going to be taking that hose out. That's just a vent hose, and right behind the vent hose, there's a little cover, a little cap that I'm going to take off. For the carb sink, I built my own tool. Let's see if I can get a better shot of this. So basically all this is just a couple of vacuum gauges, some ball, I don't even call those ball switches, I guess, just to cut the air off and on. And we're just going to adjust those so that the needles don't flop around. The fuel filters, those are the Virago fuel filters. So with the fuel filters, it just helps reduce the needle bounce because the vacuum isn't constant. The vacuum goes up and down, and you'll see the needles bouncing around. It's kind of hard to do. But anyways, it's pretty simple. All this is just a couple of vacuum gauges, some decent quality ones, but still very inexpensive. I think they were like $10 each. A couple of fittings and the two little ball switches, and I'll set those. Actually, I'll set them back to zero. They're wide open this way and closed the other way. And like I said, the fuel filters just help regulate that. The changes in pressure so that it reduces the needle bounce a little bit. And then there's just fuel line hose. It's a really cheap quarter inch hose with a couple of clamps on the end. And that's all this is. I'm going to set it here in the seat. And on the Virago, I know there's some people will talk about they undo. I think there's on this side, on the right side, there's a little, there it is on the front cylinder. Yeah, it's kind of hard to see, but that's not the one you want to get at. All of the for both cylinders, the front and the rear. It's all on the left side. When you do the carb sync on the 1100, everything is on this side. And I'll show you what the manual says to do. And so all you'll need here is a 10 millimeter on this side. There's a small nut. And this just lifts off and carefully, just without banging the tank, just take this off. And I'll show you this here in a second. This is obviously a Canadian bike, and you can see it's an 84 Virago 1000, so it doesn't have the coasting enricher system which came with the Mikuni carbs. These are the Hitachi carbs, but essentially the carb sink is the same. There's a screw right down the middle, and all you're going to do is you turn it. You just experiment. If you notice that the vacuum is off, the two gauges will show you that one is pulling a little bit more than the other. It'll pulling a little more vacuum than the other one. And just experiment. Go to the right. It may make it worse. Then you'll go to the left, and all you're going to do is just bring the carbs together while you adjust the throttle and check the vacuum, the difference between the two on the two vacuum gauges. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to hook it up here. We're going to take this off. That is the mixture control valve right here. So the manual says on the 1000 not to connect it directly to the front connection, but to actually connect it here, which is why there's a connection here. This is capped off. Now, if your bike came with the AIS system, then this would be connected, and I'm pretty sure you still disconnect this. But in any case, this is for the front cylinder vacuum line, and this would be for the rear cylinder vacuum line, would be over here. Just, you can see it in behind that vent hose. So I'll take the vent hose off. That way it'll be a little bit easier to see. I should be able to just pull this. Just a vent hose. There you go. And pull that off by hand, and you can see there's the aft cylinder right there. So that's the fitting that we're going to put on the that's where we're going to attach the one of the two hoses. It doesn't matter which one you do, just pick one. And so I'll hook up one of these hoses to this one, and the other one over to there. Make sure they're tight, make sure the valves are open on the vacuum lines, and again, the engine has to be warm for this. It doesn't have to be hot. It just make sure that your choke circuit's not working, and that'll be fine. The engine should be warm and should be idling smooth, and that's about it. So connect everything up, make sure the engine's warm, and we'll get on with checking the two gauges. Okay, so since I've done the carbs, and of course I've put everything back together again. Used to struggle with the start, but here's a cold start. You know, there's absolutely no heat on here whatsoever. I can touch the exhaust pipe, and there's no heat. This bike's been in the garage here for a couple hours, and it's cooled down since I last drove it, and no choke. And we'll see how she starts up. No choke whatsoever, and the idle set to 1000, and I'll just let the bike warm up a little bit. Okay, so the two lines are connected. This one here for the front cylinder goes right to that connection right there, in line with the mixture control valve. That's for the front cylinder, and then of course the rear cylinder, the connection is right there on the manifold. Pretty easy to get off, just these two little caps, of course. And these connections, of course, they gotta be airtight. So, that's it. The valves are open, the ball valves are open, and these, once I start the bike, you'll see these fluttering like crazy. So, as you can see, the screw for this is kind of hard to see. I'll have to get the flashlight. The screw that needs to be adjusted is inside. I'm going to lift this hose up. I think you can see it there. I'm shining a light on it. I did take a photograph of it before I adjusted it. But as you can see by the setup, that I've already synced the carbs about as close as I could get it, actually. One was pulling just a tiny bit more than the other, but it was certainly a lot better than what it was when I put the carbs back in and started it up. It was idling. It was idling well, but it was kind of all over the place. I had to raise the idle up a little bit, but anyway, brought the idle back and synced it as best I could, using it with that screw. Now you're going to probably have to remove the seat and lift the tank up to get at that screw, and you get at it from the other side, and you'll have to get around that inlet hose as well. But a long screwdriver, since I know I swear by JIS, but it's not a lot of torque to move that. It's just a set screw on a spring. So if you wanted to use a long Phillips, you can reach it from the right side and then just adjust it while you're to the right and to the left until you get the two gauges synchronized, like I have on this one. So that's all there is to it. Again, you just got to make sure that the connections are airtight. I get these little fuel line hoses. This is quarter inch hose, just fuel hose that I bought from the store, hardware store. And that's all there is to syncing the carbs once you've done the carb overhaul, which I just completed. And I've had the bike out. I've made some adjustments to the, obviously after I synced the carbs, I went out and took it for a couple of test drives, put some new plugs in it, and bought the Iridium NGKs, which are really good plugs, and the E6 are another one that I, or E3, another set of plugs that I recommend. But anyway, bike was coursed. I'm up at 4,000 feet. It's hot here in the summertime, so density altitude's around 6,000. So I made a couple of adjustments until I got the plugs burning a nice medium brown. These things are known to run rich, and they're set to run rich. And it turns out that my idle set screw on both my carbs, I had to turn them in from two and a half turns. I think it was two turns I set it to. So it's in a half turn, and so now it's one and a half. And again, I'm at 4,000 feet. In the summer, it goes up, the density altitude's around 6,000, typical 5,000 to 6,000. And So it's running really strong now. It idles really well. It starts right up, no choke, and has lots of power and good crisp throttle acceleration. So it looks like everything's working the way it should. And that was, of course, after the valve adjustment and all that other stuff that I did as well. So bike's working really, really well now. Really pleased with it. And that's all there is to my carb syncing little tutorial that I, not really a tutorial, but just a carb sync video that I'm making here, just to help people out. Again, this is just a bunch of parts that I strewed together. It was less than, I think it was probably $50 or $60 by the time I got everything into it. And that's all there is to it. Hope it helps. Cheers.